Hello and welcome to this webinar on the Cambridge English approach to item writing. I'm Nick Glasson and I work in the assessment department of Cambridge Assessment English.
Hi, and I'm Annie Broadhead and I'm a writer and consultant for Cambridge English.
Thanks for joining us. Today we'll explore the Cambridge English approach to producing test material, and we hope that you'll share your experience in writing classroom tests and add any ideas or comments that you have during the webinar in the chat box.
Right, before we start, we'd like to get an idea of who our audience is. Whether you are A, training to be an English teacher, for example, doing a pre-service or initial teacher training course, or B, if you're already teaching but new to it, or C, if you've been teaching for a long time, or D, if you're not teaching but do something else. There's a poll coming up now, so when you're ready, please click on the option for you. So if you do that now, choose an option A, B, C, or D, which is closest to your teaching situation.
So while we're waiting for people to join us and to join the poll, maybe you could tell us something about your experience of teaching English, Annie?
I studied English and French, and I actually started off teaching French and liked that, and then I did some teaching English. And then I decided to specialise in teaching English as a second language. And I worked in France for a bit, and then in the UK and in Cambridge, in some private language schools in Cambridge. Mm-hmm. And what about you? What's your background?
Well, I taught in Indonesia for 7 years. And then I did a bit of teaching in the UK and came to work for Cambridge. That's my story.
Yeah. How's the poll going?
So we can see here we've had quite a lot of responses. We've got 22% saying they're already teaching but fairly new, which is B. And then for C, we've got 71% have been teaching for a long time. So, and I don't think we have anyone who says they're not a teacher, or perhaps a small minority. Okay, so let's move on there. So Annie, you've been working with us to produce tests for more than 20 years. Could you say something about the Cambridge English approach to writing test material?
Yes, and the first thing to say is that there are some guiding principles common to tests, and they are validity, reliability, impact, practicality, and fairness. These are important because when a test is valid, reliable, has a positive impact and is fair, we can say it's a good test.
So can you tell us what validity means?
Yeah, validity relates to test purpose. We must be clear about exactly what abilities we're testing and what the results of the test are going to be used for. We say that a test is valid for a specific purpose when it measures what we intended it to measure. For example, if an English language test, if we asked what the capital of Spain was, the test would not be valid because we'd be testing general knowledge or geography, not English.
Exactly. So, okay, that's validity. What about reliability?
Okay, so a test can be reliable in several ways. One of the important things to ensure is that all the items are written according to the test specifications, which give guidance on text length, level, suitable vocabulary, grammatical complexity, and so on. Another thing is that the mark schemes must be clear and accurate. These are just some of the things that make a test and their results reliable.
Yes, that's right. We're focusing here on item writing, but there are other factors such as the test environment, you know, the layout of the room, which can also obviously affect reliability. Okay, so what about impact?
An exam has very important effects and consequences for the test takers, their parents, teachers, schools, employers, and so on. These effects are referred to as impact. The content of a test can heavily influence what's taught in classes and how it's taught, which in turn affects how learners learn. For example, a lot of our listening tests include a note-taking task, which is a real-world skill, and so has a positive impact on learning and teaching.
Yes, that's really important, because tests have a huge influence on everyone involved. And then going into practicality, that's presumably about administering the test.
Yes, yeah. When we talk about practicality, we're referring to how realistic it is to produce, mark, and administer a test with respect to the resources needed. There's a difference between a classroom test and a large national or international exam in terms of practicality. Mm-hmm. That's obvious. And I'd just like to add something else, that a test has to be fair. It shouldn't discriminate against any subgroups of test takers or give advantage to other groups. It should also be fair to those who rely on the results.
So, speaking of classroom tests, we'd love to know whether any of you have produced classroom tests for use with your learners. So we're just going to ask you to do another poll now. You just need to choose yes or no with this one in answer to the question, have you ever written a classroom test for your students? So you just decide if you've done that or you haven't.
And that can be any sort of classroom test, yeah, can't it? Even like a vocabulary test at the end of the week or something like that. Or it might be a larger test at the end of the year for your group.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's see. So we're getting some results in, yeah, already. As you might expect, the vast majority are saying yes.
Okay.
we've got 86%. So yes, we expected you to say something like that, because obviously, as a teacher, certainly you're going to be asked to do testing. Okay, so let's just move on. Let's focus on the Cambridge English approach to item writing. Mm. There's quite a bit of jargon involved. Yeah. So let's look at that now.
Yeah, okay. Right, for example, here's a multiple choice task. So you can see this on your screen now. You can see the rubric. That's the instructions for completing the task. Can you see that at the top? There may also be a context setting sentence to help the candidate engage with the task. Then you have the individual items. We use the word item to refer to an individual question, which may be part of a larger task on an exam paper. On this three-option multiple-choice item, you can see that it has what we call the stem on the left and the options A, B, and C on the right.
Yes, Annie, these are some of the words that are particular to the work of item writers. Yeah. What's the role of an item writer like exactly?
Well, for Cambridge Assessment English, most item writers are external consultants who are commissioned to write tasks. This might be for a particular question paper, for example, B2, first listening, or perhaps B1, preliminary reading. It may be for a range of papers and a range of levels. There are item writer guidelines which item writers use to help them write. And writers are also supported by a chair. That's an experienced item writer. The chair is there to provide expert advice and to help item writers to produce valid items. The chair also plays an important role in the editing process.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned editing there. This is probably a good point for me to describe briefly how material is produced for most of our tests here at Cambridge. This slide shows the main stages that test materials go through. The first stage is commissioning, when writers are formally invited to write material. The item writer then submits the tasks they've been commissioned for in line with the relevant item writer guidelines, which Annie's already mentioned. This is then reviewed by the chair, an experienced item writer, and the assessment manager. So there's three people involved in the initial review. There are three possible outcomes at this first review point. Material may go straight to editing if it's completely suitable and in line with the guidelines. It may go back to the writer with a request for revisions, or it may be rejected. The writer then submits the material for editing. So they've taken on board the feedback and then they've amended the task in line with the feedback, and then it's submitted again for editing, where it is reviewed again and a final version of the task is produced. I use the word final here, but what we mean is that the task is ready for pre-testing. Tasks are then pre-tested on a representative sample of learners from different first language backgrounds, different first languages, before being used in a live test.
Yeah.
So if we talk about a multiple choice item, what is it that might make it good or bad?
First of all, items need to be written so that the correct option or key is clearly in the input text, and the correct answer has to have the same meaning as in the text. The correct answer is often paraphrased to test the candidate's ability to process language.
Okay, but what about the incorrect options? How do you write those?
Yeah, they're usually rooted in the text in some way, either in the original source, those ideas have already been there, or in the text adapted by the item writer. Adapting source texts often means including ideas for these incorrect options. A similar word or topic may appear in the text and in the option, but that option doesn't actually answer the question for the item. All the incorrect options, which we call distractors, should be plausible. Here's an example of the first item from a reading task at B2 level. It's from Cambridge English First. So on your screen now, you'll see multiple choice questions. An exciting journey for Louisa. Just have a minute to look at that. So quickly look at the text and then go down to the stem and the options. And from the stem and options, we can see that this item is focusing on Louisa's feelings about the application form. So you can see that in the stem.
Probably as part of this, you've tried to work out what the key is. Hopefully you've worked out that it's A, which is true to text and paraphrases the information in the last sentence of the paragraph, the bit where it says, never mind, she'd had everything checked, nothing should go wrong. Option A sums up Louisa's overall feeling of confidence without repeating the vocabulary or phrasing from the text itself.
So that's the key. And all the incorrect options begin with an adjective. So you can see they're all adjectives of feeling. They are similar in length, so they all look equal when you see them as a set. And that's what makes a good set. They look equal, they look plausible. They're all rooted in the text. B and D are attractive distractors because they're plausible ideas that refer to things mentioned in the text. For example, B, whether everything would arrive intact, and D, the idea of a time limit. For option C, the adjective silly is a paraphrase of naive in the text, and it doesn't match her overall feeling at the moment, so it's wrong.
That's another important point to mention here. The language that we can see here used in the stem and the options should not be more difficult than the language in the reading text or the listening script itself. I mean, hopefully that's obvious from this sample that you can see it's of a sort of parity in terms of difficulty.
Yeah. Okay, so now let's move away from multiple choice items and look at what we call productive items. That's where the candidates have to write a word or short phrase. It's crucial for the key to be tight. In other words, we have to write texts and items so that there's only one answer.
Yes, the key should also be constrained so that the candidate doesn't write additional words for this reason. Keys to productive items are very often concrete nouns. it's important too to signpost or cue the items within the text to help the candidate know where they are. So let's look at an example from a listening task.
Okay. Right, so you should see it on your screen now, a text about glowworms. Nice topic.
You can see the kind of context setting. You will hear a woman giving a talk about glowworms. The F colon at the beginning of the script is just to denote that it's a female speaker. And then it starts with good evening. So have a quick read through the script. And the item is number 2 at the bottom. And you're looking primarily at how the item is cued, because particularly with a listening text, you need to cue the listener so that they're kind of following the task.
Yeah. So here you can see that the item is signposted or cued in the text with "The male can be easily distinguished from the female by the fact that..." And this is paraphrased in the item by "The male glowworm looks different from the female because..." The key to this item is wings. In this task type, there may or may not be distraction, depending on the complexity of the item. So if it's already quite a challenging word or phrase for that level, it might not be necessary to have distraction in a productive task.
Mm. And are there any other things, aspects to consider when writing an item?
Yes, because if you're writing a multiple item, a multi-item text, it's important that one item doesn't overlap with another item in terms of focus or key, as this can confuse the candidates.
Mm-hmm. Cambridge English also needs to make sure that items about unsuitable topics such as religion or war and things like that are not included, as these might cause candidates distress. Cambridge English produces tests that are taken by candidates in different countries around the world, so we have to ensure that all tasks are appropriate for such a wide range of candidates. Why don't we look at some examples of items that don't work well and discuss how to improve them?
Yeah, okay. Right, this is a good idea. So here's an example of an item that needs some rewriting. It's a multiple choice item from a reading task about a town called Melton.
So we'll just give you a moment to have a look at that. You don't necessarily need the text for this, so it's just to look at the item, to look at the stem and the options.
Yeah, look at the options. So Nick, what do you notice about this set of options?
Well, I think the thing that stands out, hopefully for everyone, is that D is visibly shorter than the others. Mm. Structurally, it's different because it uses the indefinite article rather than the definite article. And the options could be improved by changing D to something like the lack of green spaces.
Yeah.
Just to make it look the same as the others, to follow the same structure.
Mm. Another important thing to think about is word spots between items and texts. That's where the same word or phrase appears in both the item and the text. As a general rule, all options or no options should have word spots. This example is of a listening multiple choice item. Just take a minute to look at it. Again, you can see the context sentence, the question, and 3 options.
And then the dialogue with Dan and Lucy.
Yeah, and think about what I just said about word spots.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If you've got any comments on this, type it in and we can see what you're thinking as you're analysing this text and the question.
Mm. I can see some of you are getting the key right, which is good. As Annie said, look as well at what we were saying about word spots.
So word spots means you're looking for a word that appears in those options, or it might even be in the stem in some cases, and the same word appears in the text. And then you've got to check if there are word spots in all the options and the text, or none, or is it in this case just one?
Okay, should we go through it?
Yeah, okay.
All right. So I think most of you have correctly identified C as the key. And it paraphrases, make a bit of extra effort with your appearance. Practice in option A also appears in the script, and so is a word spot. But the phrasing of options B and C paraphrases advice given in the script without including the same vocabulary. The item can be improved by changing practice in option A to rehearse. A is also shorter than the others, and so it could be made longer by adding your talk to make option A rehearse your talk in advance.
Yeah, that's good. That's a good example of how, when you start working on a text as an item writer, how you work with it all the time to be improving the stem, the options, and the text itself. Another point with this one is that B is more idiomatic than the other two options, and that could be rewritten. It could be something like, make sure the audience is listening, something like that. Mm-hmm. We also discussed earlier how there should be one clear key to an item. Let's look at this listening item. So another one's coming up on your screen.
So should be headed as items that don't work, and it's, you will hear a pilot called Peter Marks talking about his job. And you've got the item at the bottom. So again, have a look through the text, have a look at the item, and then obviously think about what the key is, because that helps. And then think about how clear the key is.
Yeah.
Because that's really a fundamental thing, that the key needs to be clear.
Yes. Right, type in your answers in the chat box, and we'll have a look to see what people are saying. How would you analyse this one?
I can see some people are getting the key right.
Yes, lots of people. Yeah.
Okay. So I think we've established here that the key should be A. It's meant to be A, but it's not really clear because B and C are also possible keys. The stem is also not very easy to process as it includes negative phrasing, advises against and aren't, which I think is something that some of you have picked up on. I think this item needs to be completely rewritten, doesn't it?
I agree. It needs a complete rethink because the key is not absolutely clear, and you've got the wording of the stem, that negative wording.
Again,
these are some of the things that when item writers perhaps start writing, you know, their initial draft might contain this sort of thing, and then they'd work with it to eliminate these problems.
Which is just to go back to what we were saying about the process, which is why we have these different steps, because at each point you can look at it afresh and review it. You know, we mentioned the importance of avoiding culturally specific references. Let's look at another listening task. So you should see a task coming up now. It's about a young actor talking about her career. So again, we'll just give you a minute or two perhaps to have a look through the text. Remember, this time we're looking for things that might be sort of culturally specific. So just quickly scan through the text and then have a look for anything that you think might be more culturally specific and not necessarily suitable for a global candidature.
Yes.
And again, if you want to use your chat function to give us your thoughts about what would be the culturally specific element or elements. I can see one of you's already got it.
Julia Green. Well done, Julia. Oh, yeah, Andreas, Jill, yes, you've spotted it already. So the key is A, and that's clear, but equity card might not be understood by candidates as it's specific to the UK. It's that card that actors and performers are required to have in the UK. This can be removed from the text without affecting the key. And again, this is the process you'd go through of adapting the text to rule out those things. Okay.
Earlier we talked about our unsuitable topics list, sometimes referred to as our taboo list. We have an extensive list that's used in order to avoid distressing or offending candidates. Here's an example text. It's an extract from a listening script. Just take a minute to look through it and just ask yourself and perhaps respond in the chat, do you think this is a suitable text, particularly a suitable text for a global language test?
Yeah, is there anything that might be distressing to any candidates in it?
Yeah, or deemed unsuitable.
Yeah. Type your answers in the chat box.
Yeah. So just a quick reading, and then if you want to summarise what you think might be unsuitable about it in the chat, that would be good.
Oh, somebody's got it.
Here we go.
Stephen.
Yeah.
Stephen Walker.
Well done, Stephen.
Yeah. Walker. Yes. Yes. Okay, you've got it. So in this example, the references to shooting animals for their skins and killing elephants for their tusks could potentially be very distressing for test takers. And that's why this text is unsuitable for Cambridge English exams. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm.
Another important point is to ensure that the item is testing language only. Again, let's look at an example. So now you've got a problem item. It's you overhear two boys talking about a trip to the cinema. What time will Bob meet Sam? So again, just have a very quick look at the options and then very quickly read the script. And just let us know through the chat what you think the problem is with this item. Or problems.
You mean they're getting worse?
Well, possibly.
It's text like this. This is the sort of thing that we use for training item writers. That because if you can spot the mistakes and flaws, it means that you won't make those mistakes when you're writing your own tests. So let's see what people have...
Hey, Katerina already flashed up with the answer.
Oh, yeah, the answers are going so fast, I can't even... Yes, get the names of people.
Okay.
Yes. This is a flawed item because it requires candidates to do a mathematical calculation to arrive at the correct answer. By calculating that 7:55 is 20 minutes earlier than 8:15. It's also a bad item in that the options use a mix of conventions for expressing time. This is confusing and possibly misleading for candidates. Yeah. Well done, everybody. You got that very easily.
Yeah. We also avoid what is described often in item writing as world knowledge when writing items. This means that we want to ensure that candidates can only answer a question through reading a text rather than their knowledge of the world. Let's look at an example of an item. So again, we're not giving you the text here, you've just got the stem and then the options. But again, same thing as before, if you want to just indicate what you think the problem is in the text chat box, and we'll see what you're putting in. So what might be wrong with this item?
And think about what Nick said just before we saw this item. Yeah. Somebody put it tests general. Jeremy Phillips, you can answer it from your head. Yeah. That's the point, isn't it? Because without even looking at the text to accompany this item, it's clear that the answer to the item is A, as that's the logical reason for taking a business course. The other two options are highly unlikely. Mm. So they go against what we were saying before about the incorrect option should be plausible.
Mm, absolutely, yeah. It's important also that items are phrased clearly and that the options are comparable in terms of the processing required. Let's look at another item.
Yep.
So here you can see one headed problematic phrasing. It says, according to the passage, most people don't understand instructions unless they are, and then it's got three options. So again, very quickly, just if you want to in the chat, just tell us what you think might be wrong with this item.
Let's have a look at the...
That's an interesting point, actually.
Option C, harder to process, yeah.
Yep.
Yes.
Yep.
Yes.
Good. Sorry, we would name you, the ones who've got it, but you're coming
so
up so fast.
So many people are answering. Yes. Yeah, there are a number of points here that make this item unsuitable. First, it's not clear what there, you know, the word at the end of the stem, what it refers to, because it could be people or instructions. It's ambiguous. In addition, option C is much longer and of a higher level of difficulty. Somebody put that in the, mm-hmm. in the chat box. Well done again.
Yeah. Thanks for responding. So to summarise, we've covered some of the points that Cambridge English places importance on when writing items. Having a clear key, clear and unambiguous phrasing, assessment of language and not world knowledge, avoidance of unsuitable topics, avoidance of culturally specific references, mm-hmm. like we saw with the equity card, consistency in phrasing and length of options, and avoiding things like having mathematical calculations as a part of the item.
Yeah. I mean, you've got this list of points on your screen. So this really summarizes the points that we've covered today. Mm. And these are some of the main points, but obviously not everything. So thank you for watching this webinar, and we've got some time now for your questions. So if you'd like to type in a question for us to answer, do that now in the chat box, and we'll keep our eye on the chat box and we'll answer as many of them as we can in the time we've got. So
we've already got some.
Let's have a look.
We've got a query about...
Oh, somebody's asked about copyright. That's a very complex and legal issue. I mean, I'm not a legal person, so not really qualified to answer that from the legal point of view. But you do have to be very, very careful. It's always good to use an original text as your source for reading and listening, because then you know it's real language, you know, that's what's going out there in the real world. But having said that, we can't just lift somebody else's work. So either in some way copyright has got to be acknowledged, or you've got to take the ideas from it and rewrite it so that it's not the same as the original, it's unrecognizable as the original. Very tricky point, very delicate point.
Yeah,
you have to get things checked properly.
Yeah. Jamie's asked, are negatives in the options okay? Because we talked about negatives in the stem.
Yeah.
But whether we'd have negatives in the options themselves.
Yeah, I write and chair quite a few papers at Cambridge English, and even now, I mean, you probably know that the key test is being revised, and it's starting, the revision starting next year, and I work on the listening paper of that. And previously, at that level, so that's A2, we haven't had negatives in the question because we thought that that might be too challenging. Obviously not in the, we would never have it in the STEM and the options, but we did quite a bit of trialing to see if that level, A2, could cope with having a negative question. You know, why didn't Lucy go to the party? And they were fine. Yeah, they answered it perfectly. So when that revision comes out for that level, you see negatives in either the STEM or the options, but not both, because then you get that double negative problem.
It's becoming more about logic deduction than language comprehension. I think on a related point, we just probably want to emphasize that texts and items are always checked for level. So they're checked via things like the English vocabulary profile, to make sure that they are suitable for the CFR level that we're aiming to target with text.
Yeah, that's a good point.
It's written into the item writer guidelines, and it's something that's kind of intrinsic to the meetings that we have and the reviews throughout, really, isn't it?
If you don't use that or don't know about it, just Google English vocabulary profile and you'll find it.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
There's a nice question here from Thomas about, are texts mostly original or written for the test?
Yeah, that's connected with what we were saying before about copyright as well, that for Cambridge English, all, even low-level texts, are based on original text, but there is, the texts are adapted. You often have to adapt texts for various reasons, for the distraction, for the level, perhaps to take out one bit that's culturally specific or distressing. So a lot of the things we've already mentioned today are areas of the adapting a source text process. So I suppose it's a little bit of both. You take the idea and a lot of it from the original and then adapt it. But bear in mind what I said earlier about copyright. Let's have a look.
I don't know which ones you want to.
Oh, well, somebody, Denise has asked about using video in tests. We don't on any of the papers I work with for Cambridge English. Can you think of anywhere we do?
I can't think of anything off the top of my head.
It's connected with practicality. You know, one of the, when we looked at those guiding principles, practicality was one. And you could argue that it would be a very good thing to do, for example, for listening, if you had a video and the listening. You'd have to think carefully, though, about how much meaning was transmitted by the visual aspect of it, rather than the language per se for itself. But it is a very interesting idea and development that I'm sure is in the pipeline for lots of tests. It will raise other item writing issues. It will definitely raise issues of practicality because of the expense, the resources that are needed to produce that. But interesting idea. Forward-looking.
There's one here about, so any more technical considerations, would an item not refer to the first or last line of a text?
Oh, which is about Hiker's. Is it Hiker or Helker? Or
even with Hiker.
It's so small, Hiker. somebody has asked about, would an item not refer to the first or last line of a text or paragraph in a text? This is a very interesting question because actually, if you do any sort of writing training, you know, as a journalist or creative writing courses, that sort of thing, you're told or you're taught to get the main idea or the hook, if you like, in that first sentence or last sentence of a paragraph. So this actually is a feature of good writing. So it would be a little bit false to manipulate a text always to make sure that that didn't happen. You might do it sometimes. You might adapt the text to sort of embed that idea into the middle of a paragraph if you thought it was a bit easy. But better might be to leave it where it is, that idea of the original writer, and make the question, the processing of language that's required, the right level that you will be able to test the language level.
Mm-hmm.
Again, a really interesting question.
We've got another question here, which is how many options are best for multiple choice questions? Because we've shown a variety of multiple choice items, but are there any rules about that?
Yeah, well, I don't know about rules, but there are pros and cons to using different numbers of options, because starting from the lowest one, binary, so if you've only got two options, like sometimes you have yes, no, true, false, the problem with that is that if somebody guesses, they've got 50% chance of being right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So an item might not discriminate in that it might not show the difference between a really good learner at that level and a weaker learner.
Mm-hmm.
Then the most typical one, I think, is three options, which seems to work really well at, you know, levels from A1 right up. But when you do get to the higher levels, I think once you get to certainly C1, the fourth option does allow you perhaps to tease out the cohort that you're testing in their level. By that I mean that when you've got four options, you get a spread of answers, so you'll be able more clearly to see the people who are very good at that level and the ones who are weaker.
Well, it depends on the input as well, doesn't it? Because if the C1 input's longer, it's going to have more ideas in it, so you've got more to play with in terms of making distraction as well.
And that's a very good point, because one of the problems with writing four options is writing the fourth option. Often you've got clear ideas for three in the input text, and then you've got to have another idea for the fourth option, and you don't want it to look as though, you know, that's the weak one or nobody will choose it.
Well, as we said, it's got to be rooted in the text and it's got to be plausible for it to be a suitable distractor.
Yes, so, yes.
Okay.
Hard to write.
There's another question here. Do questions always go in the order in which information appears in the reading text or a listening audio?
Generally speaking, in Cambridge exams, yes.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the only exception is a global question, isn't it?
Yes.
Which can cover the whole text.
Yes, yes. So in a reading text, you might have that, for example, that you've got something that comes at the end, or it's usually at the end, I think, which is testing your kind of global understanding of the text.
Yes.
Similarly, I think, as we said in previous discussions, you if you've got an item where two people agree in a listening, it kind of comes where that point is in the dialogue, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So it's very much in order. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Let's see if there's any other questions. What time are we at?
Ah, good question. It's Heike again.
Yep.
Thanks, Heike. Why no authentic audio used for listening tasks? Good question. Quality of sound recording is one thing. If you take something from a live talk, a broadcast of any type, the quality of the recording is slightly compromised by the time an exam board, take it, copy it, etc. There might be background noises in it, you know, crash bang wallops going on that you don't want to be there. And the other thing is that it's very rare, perhaps I should say quite rare, choosing my words carefully, that an original text in its entirety will be completely suitable. Mm. Most original live broadcasts, obviously they're not made for test purposes. So the speaker is not thinking about, oh, I need to put a distractor in here,
yeah,
or I shouldn't refer to that because it's culturally sensitive. Mm-hmm. They have a completely different agenda.
Mm.
So there will be, you know, nearly all the time, you'll need to adapt the text. And once you start doing that, it's no longer the original text anyway.
Yeah. And I think, as we said before, there would be copyright issues as well if you were just lifting things straight from the source.
Yes.
I can see that some of you are asking for sort of much more detail, and unfortunately, we can't kind of cover that so much today. What I was going to say was just that when it comes to materials, you can always find the handbooks on our website, which are freely available, which give you basically our sort of test specifications, which give you some information about the items and what they're aiming to focus on. And for people who really want to know a lot more about the kind of underpinning theories behind our tests, there are volumes called Studies in Language Testing. This is the example from Listening, which kind of goes into a lot more detail about the sort of the theories underpinning the tests, and also issues like authenticity of listening input and things like that, because that is covered in here in terms of contextual validity and that kind of thing. So I just wanted to mention that.
Yes, because we can't cover everything today,
exactly.
So it's a good source to go to. How are we doing for time? Have we got time for one or two more questions?
Yeah, let's do a couple more.
Oh, so we've just done the references, good.
Mm-hmm. What about this one? So for questions where it's a productive answer,
yeah,
does spelling need to be correct?
Yeah, it's different in different tests. And that's why you do need things like the specifications, because that will tell you if that is a requirement of a particular test.
Mm-hmm.
So some tests have that the spelling must be completely correct. As I mentioned, I chair key and advanced listening and proficiency, where there are productive tasks. And at A2, so key, we have some acceptable misspellings.
Yeah.
And they're usually on words in English that are quite tricky to spell, like February, I think, is one of them.
Mm.
And if somebody's written it in a more sort of phonetic way, but it's clear what the answer is, it's acceptable. But one thing you've got to be careful about, that the misspelling doesn't actually then produce a completely different word.
Yeah.
So that the if you passed on your notes in real life to somebody else, they would be confused.
Yeah, that's a really important point as well, isn't it? Because with listening note-taking, what you're talking about really is the ability to take that note in a way that's accurate enough to be communicated to somebody else rather than something that can't be understood.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, we'll probably just do one more question.
Somebody's mentioned, Giuseppina has mentioned the task type where you've got right, wrong, doesn't say. Or there's another one, isn't there? True. Right, wrong, doesn't say.
Yeah, there are a few variants.
I know exactly what you mean. They are difficult to write. That doesn't say, or not mentioned, I think some tests have it worded like that, is difficult to write because sometimes you get, when you look at the text, you think, well, that could be implied.
Mm.
And
mm.
where is the line between doesn't say and implied?
Mm.
I mean, there are task types like that, and they do work, but I think when they're pre-tested, you know, it's hard. A lot of work goes into getting them through, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, we mentioned pre-testing fleetingly. This is where we would get some statistics on how items and options had performed, so in a true false not given, or a yes, no, not given, or whatever you call it, you would have statistics to show how many people had decided whether it was false or not given, and then you, in the review meeting, you would kind of decide whether that was an appropriate or fair item, basically, at the end of the day.
So,
they present certain constraints, don't they, as an item that the straightforward multiple choice one doesn't. With a multiple choice, you've got the freedom that you can amend or tweak an option to make it work better or, you know, in a certain way, whereas with the true, false, not given, it really does mean you're going back to the text and reframing something there or rephrasing it. So.
I mean, the other interesting thing about that is it's quite a good real-world skill, though, isn't it? Because if you were in some sort of meeting and you want to think, well, did that person actually say that or not?
Yeah.
It is a good thing to think about and be able to process in another language, but they are fiendishly difficult to write and get through to tests.
Yeah. Okay, I think we'll stop there.
Yeah, I think that's all we have time for today, isn't it?
Yeah.
So thank you for all your questions. We've enjoyed reading them and responding to them as much as we can in the time we have. And we hope that it's been useful and interesting for you all. So thanks and goodbye.
Yes, goodbye. Thank you.